There's many examples of how to implement forest stand improvement for deer. Here, we have a relatively young stand that has established through natural succession. Years and years ago, well, about 30 years ago, this used to be a pasture, and it was abandoned, grew up in trees, and this is the result however many years later. In this area of the property, the landowner has determined on the map, this is an area of which he wants heavier cover, much more dense cover, to hold deer in this area, to use it as a predictable source for deer to be coming and going from to aid in huntability of the property. So, in this example, we're going to implement forest stand improvement, and we're going to go through some examples of which trees we might fail, which trees we might fail and allow to sprout because of the browse value, which trees we might fail and spray the stump to prevent them from sprouting, which trees we might girdle and spray just to kill and leave standing, and which trees we might hinge cut to provide immediate horizontal cover that would also supplement the cover that will come in the next few years from regenerating woody stems coming from the ground up. All right, we're gonna walk up in here and treat this area. You see what it looks like now. It's 324. I have an assistant with a squirt bottle, and we're gonna put it to use. This is American Elm, and it's a desired browse by whitetails, and especially for a tree that's 10 inches and less in DBH, this is a really good one to fail and not treat the stump to allow it to sprout, because by doing so, we will provide increased browse for deer. And the newly sprouting leaves from the cut stump will have elevated levels of various minerals, especially phosphorus and calcium, over the leaves that would be at this height right here. If we sampled these leaves, this would be low to medium nutritional quality. Leaves sprouting, or leaves from sprouts off of the cut stump, are going to be considerably higher, oftentimes twice as nutritious as these leaves here. Now, from this fresh cut elm stump, there'll be lots of sprouts coming up. You'll have nutritious browse available. Looks like this was a 19-year-old tree. This is a honey locust, as you can see here from the thorns. Just because of that, it's not very easy to handle, of course, but deer will eat the sprouts of honey locust. They are nutritious. It would be medium in preference, but decent. Here we have a shingle oak. And you have to look up, not just down, but when you look up, you can see the crown of the shingle oak is competing with the crown of this elm and the crown of that honey locust. So we're gonna cut this elm down. We're gonna allow it to sprout. We're gonna girdle the honey locust because it's considerably larger, and felling it is not a problem, but I don't necessarily want all of that dead material right here. I would rather have more vertical stems coming up from sprouting trees coming up, as well as horizontal cover from some hinge trees, which we will do. To girdle and kill the tree, all we need to do is make a shallow cut around the tree, going just inside the cambium layer, which is that inner bark layer where nutrients are transported from the leaves to the roots and vice versa. So we will sever the cambium layer with a girdle and then apply the appropriate herbicide to kill the tree. Note how we connected the girdle so it's solid and continuous all the way around the tree.
Now we're just gonna put a little herbicide right in the ring.
Craig told me you don't have to douse it, you just want a little bit, because every squirt is money.
Although the jug of herbicide may cost $150, $250, depending on what you're buying, to treat individual trees this size might work out to just a couple of cents. On average, you're looking at somewhere in the neighborhood of $8 an acre in herbicide cost when implementing forest stand improvement like this. Of course, that's going to vary with tree density and the number of trees you kill, but on average, we've calculated this over several years in many different stands, and it's in the neighborhood of $8 per acre, which I think is pretty doggone efficient. And what we use is a mixture of Garlon 3A, 50%, water, 40%, and Arsenal AC at 10%, mixed in that order. If you mix the Garlon and the Arsenal, which is triclopyr and imazapyr, on top of each other, it can gel in the bottle, and obviously you don't want that. There's always questions about, if you use imazapyr, which is soil active, will that kill the other non-target trees? And the answer is no, not at the rate and the application that we are using. We have done this for 30 plus years and literally hundreds of thousands of trees, and the only incident, and I could count them on two hands, that I have seen non-target stems killed with this application is with clonal species. That is, trees that are sharing the exact same root system. But using this application, you're not going to harm, much less kill, that oak, that oak, that oak, or anything else around here that you did not treat. This is a very effective mixture. We use it because Garlon is weak on a couple of species. Imazapyr is weak on a couple of species. So we mix them together at that rate, and we kill whatever we spray, which is sensible when you're treating mixed species stands such as this. We're gonna hinge cut some for immediate horizontal cover. Here we hinge cut an elm, left plenty of what we call meat. It's good if you can only cut about 50% of the way through the tree. Oftentimes you need to cut a little more than that. Get it to lean, and then we will place the top on top of another stem to keep it elevated off the ground, providing great areas for deer to get in, bed down, feel safe and secure. They use this in a big way. Well, we've been cutting for 32 minutes. And in 32 minutes, we've covered not quite, but almost an acre. And, you know, minus some conversation and explaining things, on average, you're looking at covering about 8 acres plus in a day. That's if you've got somebody to help you with a squirt bottle. You got a cutter and somebody with a squirt bottle. And there's lots of ways that you can use hinge cutting. And I'm not trying to proclaim that any one way is better than another. I'm just saying that in this example, it's convenient and efficient to use hinge cutting in combination with girdling, spraying, and with felling. We're felling trees that we want the sprouts. We're felling and spraying the stumps of the trees that we don't want to resprout. We're girdling and killing the trees that we don't want that are relatively large and we don't want the additional debris in the stand. And we're leaving the desirable species. And we'll walk in and show you what it looks like on the inside, but you will see that I didn't just close everything down into a solid mat or proverbial brush pile. We left spaces through the entire area where deer can walk about, get in and out easily, and also around mast trees where they can get to the mast, and in this case, acorns, when they have fallen. making it very attractive to deer and somewhere that you can pretty reliably count on them being, especially if you treat a large enough area. In my opinion, the best size for a bedding block, as I like to call them, is in the neighborhood of 10 to 15 acres. But a 10 acre bedding block will reliably hold a lot of deer and give you a good knowledge of where deer are gonna be and what you might hunt around, hunt off of with regard to wind direction and your access.